bunch of copies of the space frog drawing I made. You can post them in places where you think people will see them. Thank you so much!
What do I have a problem this... What I have a feeling this is gonna cause problems.
Just put the pictures up where you think lots of people are going to see them.
Alright, 0 of 6 space frog drawings.
Bye!
Bye! Space frog from outer space. A little girl named Renee asked me to help her spread some joy in Sidonia by putting up her drawings of her character, Space Frog from Outer Space. Stack of space frog drawings. Huh? Well, they look like they're different kinds. This one's sleeping, but there's... You can see the bottoms here are different. Alright. Well, the first one's gonna be, I guess, up on another floor. That way. Alright, well, we'll finish looking around here. Invading people's privacy. There's books. Oh, I didn't know you were in here with me. What the hell? Where'd you come from? David Copperfield. Chapter 1. I am born. Wherever I shall turn, whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life or whether that station will be held by anybody else, these pages must show. To begin my life with the beginning of my life, I record that I was born, as I have been informed and believe, on a Friday at 12 o'clock at night. I was remarked that the clock began to strike and I began to cry simultaneously. First published as a serial from 1849 to 1850, Charles Dickens' David Copperfield tells the tale of a grown man looking back on his own life and all the events that shaped him. Right. Hard Times. Book the First, Sewing, Chapter 1, The One Thing Needful. Needful things. Now what I want is facts. Teach these boys and girls nothing but facts. Facts alone are wanted in life. Plant nothing else and root out everything else. You can only form the minds of reasoning animals upon facts. Nothing else will ever be of any service to them. This is the principle on which I bring up my own children, and this is the principle on which I bring up these children. Stick to facts, sir. You like facts. By far the smallest of Charles Dickens' novels, Hard Times chronicles the lives of the residents of Coketown, a fictional Victorian industrial mill city. It's a pretty unfortunate name. What's that? Nothing? Dover Beach again? Does this item not exist? Hold on a second. Again? We just had one. Why is it increasing in frequency? Well, I'm up to my abnormal activity, so I'll resume that instead. Interesting. Coming in? I want to close the door so I can steal stuff. Possibly. Definitely gonna access that computer there. Oh, these are takes anyway. The Light of Stars. Written in the summer of 1838, Longfellow's The Light of Stars is a stirring tribute to the cosmos before humanity had ever explored it. The following is a single, beautiful stanza. Within my breast there is no light, but the cold light of stars. I give the first watch of the night to the red planet Mars. The start of the unconquered will, he rises in my breast, serene and resolute and still and calm and self-possessed. The Learned Astronomer. When I heard the learned astronomer, when the proofs, the figures were arranged in columns before me, when I was shown the charts and diagrams to add, divide, and measure them, when I sitting heard the astronomer where he lectured with much applause in the lecture room. How soon, unaccountable, I became tired and sick, till rising and gliding out, I wandered off by myself in the mystical moist night air, and from time to time looked up in perfect silence at the stars. Walt Whitman's When I Heard the Learned Astronomer, while only one stanza, neatly encapsulates the author's disdain for the scientific overanalysis of nature's beauty. Well, how dare you have disdain? I have disdain for your disdain. Alright, let's where is she? Are you actually in here with me, stealthed?
I just know people are going to love those new drawings of Space Frog.
They might indeed. But I really... Just stay out there then, because I want to access this. And I don't know if I'm supposed to be doing it. Oh, it's Renee's journal. This is kind of wrong of me. Vacation. Today I asked Mom if we could go visit another planet sometime soon, but she said I couldn't because she and Dad have to work. They always have to work, and it sucks. I really want to go somewhere else because Sidonia is so boring sometimes. I like playing with Taye, I think she said. I thought it was Taye's on day. But there's nowhere to go. I just thought it was Taye. It's always here or his place, and there's nowhere to run around and play. They always say we can't run around the plaza because we could fall off the side, but we don't even go near the sides. Boo. Need to go down to the mining area and run around there. They'd love that. Gross. Dad tried to make dinner earlier, but he tried using this new protein, and it was not good. Mom was able to fix it, but only a little bit. It still wasn't very good, and I asked both Mom and Dad not to make it again. Taye's mom. This morning I went to go play with Taye, but he said he couldn't play because his mom was feeling really sad, so he wanted to spend time with her. I wish I could do something to help her. I tried making her a funny drawing, and she said that she liked it, and it made her smile. But then she was still sad the next day. I don't know what to do, because not only do I want to play with Taye, it makes me sad when someone else is sad. Space Frog. So I thought of another idea for Space Frog. One day, the people of a small town on a new planet start getting sick, and no one knows why. But then Space Frog comes down to visit and notices all the sick people. He asks them what's going on, and they tell him that they're all getting sick for some reason, so Space Frog goes to investigate. He finds out that someone has poisoned the well. I'm still not sure who yet. I might need to make up a bad guy. Space Frog doesn't really have any enemies because he doesn't really fight anyone, but maybe this time he can have one and he can solve it by talking to them. Okay. Pictures. People are feeling mopey again. I think it's time to put up more pictures to make people happy, but Mom says I can't go out unless she and Dad are home, but they're always working. And when they're not, it's always time for something else like dinner or homework or whatever. I came up with a new drawing of Space Frog that I think people will really like too. I don't know what to do. Well, we're gonna solve that. You done looking at your hands? Oh, she went over there.
These are supposed to be luxurious condominiums? If you ask me, I find them to be rather underwhelming.
You have a very booming voice. Oh, are you Taye?
Hey, I've been seeing you around here. Best not be looking for trouble, right? I've seen some karate videos.
What are you doing with your head and arms?
Hey, who are you?
You sound completely different than what you just sounded like. I'm Cora, just visiting Sidonia.
Nice to meet you. I hope you like it more than I do here.
It's alright.
I'm Taye. I live here in the condos. Sorry, I don't usually talk to strangers, and Taye, I don't know. I guess I'm thinking about lots of different things right now. I don't really know what to say.
You overstimulated or something? So, is there a school around here or something?
Nah. There's no school in Sidonia. My mom says it's because everything's so packed together, there's no room for it. But also, there's almost no kids here either, so it doesn't make sense to have one.
Hmm.
Instead, we learn remotely. It's cool, I guess, but it'd be cooler if I got to hang out with more kids my age. Like, my friend Renee is fun to hang out with and all, but I think she probably feels the same way. Having a real school would be nice.
Hmm. What do kids do for fun in Sidonia?
I don't know. I guess we just make up some games. Usually I just hang out and talk with Renee, since she's close to how old I am. Sometimes we go to the community center, and they have stuff to do there. Like crafts, movies, music, and other activities.
Hmm.
But except not when the adults are having a meeting. Renee calls them sad meetings because everyone seems so sad in them. I asked my mom what they were, but she says it was something to do with drinking. And like, I've never gotten sad after drinking water, so I don't know what's going on.
They're AA meetings, I think. So you seem concerned about some things. Everything all right?
Yeah. I'm just worried about my mom. She gets sad all the time, and I just want to help her.
After she drinks?
She's been
water?
That way since my dad died. Only, she doesn't like me talking about it to other people, so I probably shouldn't. But you know what? Maybe you should talk to her? She says she doesn't get to talk to too many other adults much.
Okay.
Maybe talking to her would help. I don't know. It's worth a shot, though. Right?
Yeah, I'll go look for her. Maybe I'll see her at the AA meeting.
See you around.
That would be her then. Let's take a look in. Let me talk to both of them. Who is this?
I don't get that book. It'd be too much trouble.
Oh. It's him. You got a lot of cool books. Can I steal these? Look, bad people, bad jokes.
Oh, it is gonna be great to have that Dragon Star Force book in my collection.
Yeah, I should swap. Nicholas Nickleby, right? What's the... Fields of Everglass. An excerpt from the highly acclaimed novel Fields of Everglass, set in the near future during a fictional wartime era. And yet, Talat did not back down. No, sir, I won't fire on them. Regardless of what you say they did, those soldiers are once like us. They're our family. We have no reason to fight them. This impressed Florence. Was Talat really willing to put everything on the line just to protect her compatriots? She knew the war was ridiculous, but to see him face his commander now and absolutely refuse a direct order, knowing that could amount to treason. This was the same Talat no more than a week ago had carried out an order to ambush and lock up her entire squad. She knew there was a gentleness to the man, but until now she had not been able to know for sure just how reasonable he could be. You're on the line, soldier. You want to think about what you're doing and run that by me one more time? Commander Greason barked. Spittle flew. Ugh. His face was turning bright red with anger. Greason was not accustomed to disobedience. You heard me. I'm not repeating myself. Talat looked over to Florence. He knew the gravity of the situation, but she had taught him so much about this unjust war in their few short days together that in this moment he decided, even if it cost him gravely, he would do the right thing. As he noticed the other officers begin to shuffle uncomfortably, noting a break in their resolve, a smirk crossed his face. The cracks began to show. He knew the tide was about to turn, and that his small act of defiance could be the one to usher in the end of this foolish conflict. All right, Red Rover, come over. An excerpt from Lubov's Songs novel Red Rover Come Over, an alternate history where autonomous robotic rovers gained sentience, replicated, and colonized Mars before humans could form colonies. Larissa just smiled. The machine continued to blink its lights and emit faint whines as its servos whirled, unsure of how to proceed. But machine communication was Larissa's specialty. She flicked the buttons on her universal comm unit. Its LEDs blinked rapidly in response to her movements. "It's okay," she signaled through the device. "I won't hurt you. But if we have any hope of getting out of this cave, we need to work together." Larissa hadn't expected her day to go like this, trapped in a disused mining tunnel under the surface of Mars with a frightened and potentially hostile maintenance robot, but her espionage training had prepared her for similar situations. The machine clicked and beeped in response. "I trust you." It wasn't a direct translation. As precise as machine binary language was, there was still a lot of room for misinterpretation when translated to her native tongue. It was close enough. The robot seemed to relax. Its glowing aperture extended to let more light in as it gazed at her, taking in any information it could glean from her. And then it extended one of its many clamps in her direction, took hold, and with a firm yet gentle tug pulled the small robot out from under the rubble. "There we go. That's better, isn't it?" she asked, clicking out her message on her comm unit. "Now, if you could lead me out of this tunnel and back to my dropship, I can call for backup that could help your fellow machines fight back against your oppressors." You know how long it would be to type all this out in binary? The robot seemed to nod in understanding and began to wheel its way down the rocky corridor, stopping every so often to let Larissa catch up. Bad people, bad jokes one? "Knock, knock. Who's there?" "Varun." "Varun who?" "Varun, Varun, listen to that engine." An alien spider beast walks into a bar in Aquila City. Bartender asked, "What's your poison?" "Why did the Crimson Fleet pirate go to an enhanced clinic?" "He wanted more booty." "Knock, knock. Who's there?" "Neon." "Neon who?" "You put one knee on the floor to genuflect, two knees to kneel." "You hear the one about the Free Star Ranger who couldn't get into the conference?" He forgot his badge. Lewis Lupper's Bad People Bad Jokes has garnered something of a cult following in the settled systems and is particularly popular among the criminal element in the major cities. Two. "Why did the chicken cross the road?" "Huh? What's a chicken?" "Knock, knock. Who's there?" "Planet." "Planet who?" "If I throw a party, will you help me plan it?" "Oh, brother." Ecliptic mercenary says to a woman, "I've been hired to kill you, and I always get the job done." Woman says, "Can't we talk about this, son?" Says mom. "How do you keep an idiot in suspense?" Yeah, I've seen that one. "How do you get a Free Star Collective hick out of a tree?" Wave. Lewis Lupper's Bad People, Bad Jokes, Volume 2 is the follow-up to his original work and, just like its predecessor, has become a cult hit. Stealing it right here. Number 3. A Chunk's Chunk walks into a bar. Bartender says, "We don't serve food here." Chunk sit down and says, "Then I guess I'm in the right place." Knock, knock. Who's there? "Broken Sword." "Broken Sword who?" "Oh, never mind. It's pointless." How many atheists does it take to screw in a light bulb? None. They're already enlightened. What's the last thing to go through a Free Star Militia member's mind when they meet a United Colonies Marine? A laser beam. Why don't Terramorphs eat clowns? They taste funny. Unlike the first two volumes he published, Lewis Lupper's Bad People, Bad Jokes, Volume 3 never really gained much of an audience. Popular theories suggest that by the time of its release, people were already tired of Lupper's terrible jokes. Don't blame him. Crimson Cabin. Yeah, I don't think I read this. 2301 finally saw the release of Crimson Cabin, Paul Lamont's long-awaited sequel to the hit novel The Fruit Seller. Like his previous works, it sold in the millions throughout the settled systems. Freedom. Savory, delicious freedom. The hag smiled as she peered up at the open trap door. She slithered rather than climbed her way up the narrow, rickety staircase. In seconds, she emerged from the fruit cellar into the cabin proper. Someone, some unknown ally to the dark, had broken the arcane seals that had been put in place years before. Sunlight, glaring and harsh, poured in through the open front door. "And now," hissed the hag, "I will leave this cabin behind and visit my beloved Vermont once more." The Paradiso Complex. An excerpt from the Paradiso Complex, a novel quite obviously written for the Paradiso group in an attempt to market the resort to a wider audience. The writing is often atrocious and hard to take seriously. She felt the warm, perfect air on her face. Mirabella paused to adjust the straps on her bikini, then threw the ball back to Billy, who was sipping a nice, cool, perfectly mixed Perfection Aqua Blast from the Paradiso Cantina. He thought about how just days ago he was toiling away in an office building in New Atlantis, but somehow this trip to Paradiso had been the best thing that had ever happened to him. Paradiso might be the best thing to happen to anyone, he said as he playfully batted the ball out of the way. Mirabella laughed. I've been to every resort in the galaxy and none of them were as perfect as Paradiso. She bit her lip and sauntered over to Billy. Do you want to go back to my exclusive Paradiso Beach Cabana rental unit? I got it for a very reasonable price, and has all the latest comforts and amenities you'd expect from a luxurious top-quality resort. Yeah, this is like reading through an infomercial. Billy nodded, yes, and then later maybe we can go to Simon's Rooftop Lounge for some of the best live entertainment and the most delicious mixed drinks this side of the settled systems. The rest of the novel is just a painful read. Launch Point Mars. An excerpt from the nonfiction book Launch Point Mars about Mars's early role in spaceflight. Did I just read this? I think I read one similar. Along with the abundance of raw resources, the lower gravity, and the existence of the Cydonia colony base, made Mars an ideal location for launching new ships deeper into the solar system. For many years, the famous Mars launch pad was used for this purpose, and many scientific discoveries took place as a result. Humanity built outposts on numerous moons under the light of Sol. Of course, yeah, I read this. To the likes of companies like Nova Galactic. Yeah, sorry guys, I read this already. Count of Monte Cristo. On the 24th of February, 1815, the lookout at Notre Dame de la Garde signaled the three-master, the Pharaon from Smyrna, Trieste, and Naples. As usual, a pilot put off immediately, and rounding the Chateau d'If, got on board the vessel between Cape Morgiou and Rion Island. Immediately, and according to custom, the ramparts of Fort St. Jean were covered with spectators. It is always an event at Marseille, I believe, for a ship to come into port, especially when this ship, like the Pharaon, has been built, rigged, and laden at the Fosse docks and belongs to an owner of this city. All these places made up, I mean, except for Naples. Thus begins Alexandre Dumas's literary classic, which tells the story of Edmond Dantes and his exquisite revenge against the man who so deeply wronged him. And then stop that. Okay. War of the Worlds, I look at that one. Tales of Space and Time. The Crystal Egg. There was, until a year ago, a little and very grimy-looking shop near Seven Dials over which, in weather-worn lettering, the name of C. Cave, naturalist and dealer in antiquities, was inscribed. The contents of its window were curiously variegated. They comprised some elephant tusks and a perfect set of chessmen, beads and weapons, a box of eyes, two skulls of tigers and one human, several moth-eaten stuffed monkeys, one holding a lamp, an old-fashioned cabinet, a fly-blown ostrich egg or so, some fishing tackle, and an extraordinarily dirty, empty glass fish tank. There was also, at the moment the story begins, a mass of crystal worked into the shape of an egg and brilliantly polished. 1899 saw the publication of this collection of H.G. Wells' works, which is comprised of three short stories and two novellas, The Crystal Egg, The Star, The Man Who Could Work Miracles, A Story of the Stone Age, and A Story of the Days to Come. Cool. Well, there's The Fruit Seller, the first novel. In the year 2298, author Paul Lamont released the novel The Fruit Seller, however, forever cementing his role as its settled system's king of horror. "Come down here, tasty thing," rasped the voice from the fruit cellar. "I won't hurt you. Oh no, I just want a snack on your soul." Carly heard the voice in the cabin, but also in her head. She reached over to slam the trapdoor shut, but something stopped her. Some kind of infernal urge or urge. "Yes, yes," she said, as if in a trance. "My soul is delicious and will be yours." And the next thing you know, it's dead by dawn, dead by dawn. Carrie of the Cosmos. First published in the year 2301, Carrie of the Cosmos tells the story of Carrie, an overweight, lovable, unassuming young gal who unexpectedly gained cosmic powers and used them to defend the weak and underprivileged. The following is an excerpt from that work. Well, so it's not a continuation of the Stephen King novel. Okay, I'm disappointed. "Oh, really?" asked Carrie as she removed the terry cloth tie from around her waist. Her bathrobe came open, revealing the unicorn pajamas beneath. This is getting interesting until the pajamas. Just then, the tie transformed into Carrie's signature weapon, a mighty spear called the unicorn's horn. "Then maybe you should pick on someone in your own size. Me!" Carrie hurled the spear at the robber. After all, it was incredibly rude of him to try and rip off her favorite terrabue when she was grabbing a latte, and pin the unlucky larcenous lech's shirt to the wall. "Wowza," said Carrie. "Security in New Atlantis just ain't what it used to be." Okay. What about the one you're reading presently? Can I take that one too? Did I see the comment? I think so. While W.E.B. Du Bois is famous as a writer, civil rights activist, and sociologist, among other things, it is not widely known that he also penned a science fiction short story. The following is an excerpt from the comment written in 1920. "Low on the horizon lay a long white star, mystic, wonderful, and from it fled upward to the pole, like some wan bridal veil, a pale wide sheet of flame that lighted all the world and dimmed the stars. In fascinated silence, the man gazed at the heavens and dropped his rockets to the floor. Memories stirred to life in the dead recesses of his mind. The shackles seemed to rattle and fall from his soul, up from the crass and crushing and cringing of his caste, leaped the lone majesty of kings long dead. He arose within the shadows, tall, straight, and stern, with power in his eyes and ghostly scepters hovering to his grasp."
The United Colonies Department of Labor would like to remind you that working too much overtime.
Okay, have I seen it all?
And any injuries or mistakes you incur while suffering the effects of overwork.
Oh, wow! I can't wait to get that mark.
Can I access this computer? No. Oh, Star Wars. I thought it said Atari for some reason. Yeah, what happened to all your books? And you have a lot more books here? let's talk to his mother, who's not here. Oh, she's right there. She's got notebooks.
"As soon as my boy Taye is old enough to work, we're out of here."
Oh, yeah?
Ugh. Don't tell me my son Taye invited another stranger to come talk to me again, did he? That boy means well, but he's gonna drive me crazy someday.